different part in two dress rehearsals. Brian Rees for publicity help in ushering. Mr. and Mrs. Ron Niebendorf, who contributed $25 to our efforts. Mr. Jeff Chappell for emergency repairs. And Mr. Eric Adamashek, who did a wonderful job as our assistant director. Now, in the case of a fire, an announcement will be made from the stage, right here. At which point, we would like you to exit in an orderly fashion as humanly possible, right? Now, the exits are located in the balcony, on the floor here, in the rear, on both sides. House right, and backstage, on both sides. Place called Our Town. It was written by Thornton Wilder and produced by the fourth-lane Canajoharie Drama Group. In it, we see Mr. Silver, Mr. Probst, Mr. Mussmacher, Miss Cronkite, Miss Dingman, Miss Marple, and many others too numerous to mention. The name of towns, Grover's Con is New Hampshire, just across the line from Massachusetts. Latitude 42 degrees 40 minutes, longitude 70 degrees 37 minutes. The first act shows a day in our town. Date, May 7th, 1901, just before dawn. Just about. The sky's beginning to show some streaks of light in the east there. Back of our mountain. The morning star always gets wonderful bright the minute before it has to go. Well, I'd better show you how our town lies. Now, up here is Main Street. Cutting across on the left there's railroad tracks. Cross tracks to Polish Town. You know, foreign people that come to work in the mill, a couple of Canuck families and the Catholic Church. The Congregational Church is over there. Presbyterian's cross street. The Methodist and Unitarian over there. Baptist is down in the harbor. Now, next to the post office, there's the town hall. Jail's in the basement. Brian once made a speech from those very steps there. Now, along Main Street here, there's a row of stores, horse blocks, and kitchen posts in front of them. First automobile's gonna come along in about 5 years. Belong to Banker Cartwright, our town's richest citizen. He lives in the big White House Avenue. This is the grocery store, and here's Mr. Morgan's drugstore. Most everybody in town manages to look into those two stores once a day. This is a doctor's house. That here. Here's the back door. And here's a couple of trellises for those that feel they have to have scenery. This is Mr. Gibbs' garden. Corn, peas, beans, hollyhocks, heliotrope, London bird out. In those days, our newspapers come out twice a week. The Grover's Corner set. And this is Editor Webb's out. This is Miss Webb's garden, just like Mrs. Gibbs, only it's got a lot of sunflowers to it. Now right here, it's a big button. Nice town, you know what I mean? Nobody very remarkable ever come out of it. So far as we know, the earliest dates, tombstones up there in the cemetery say 1670, 1680. There, Grovers, Cartwrights, and Gibson, Herschel. Same names around here now. Well, as I said, it's early morning. The only light's on in town, and this car was towed by tracks from Polish mothers just had twins. In the Joe Crowell house, where Joe Jr. is getting ready to deliver the morning paper. And down at the depot, where Shorty Hopkins is getting ready to flag the 5:45 for Boston. Yeah, there she is. Now, naturally, out in the country, there have been lights on for some time, what with the Melkins and so on, but town folks sleep late. So, another day's begun. Yeah, there's Doc Gibbs now, coming back from that baby case. There's Miss Gibbs, come downstairs to get breakfast. Doc Gibbs died in 1930. New hospital's named after him. Miss Gibbs died first, long time ago, in fact. She went out to visit her daughter Rebecca, who married an insurance man in Canton, Ohio, and died there. Pneumonia. But her body was brought back up here. She's up there in the cemetery now, with the whole Miss Gibbs's energy. She was a Julia Hershey before she married Doc Gibbs in the Congregational Church over there. And our time, we like to know the facts about everybody. And here comes Miss Webb, come downstairs to get breakfast too. Now that's Doc Gibbs. Got the call to go to Polish Town at 1:30 this morning. And there's Joe Crowell, delivering Mr. Webb's set.
Morning, Doc.
Morning, Joe.
Want your paper down?
Yes, I'll take it.
Any boy been sick, Doc?
Home, just a pair of twins over at Miss Kraslowski's. Joe, I see your teacher, Miss Foster's getting married.
Yes, sir. Some fellow over town.
Well, I declare, how do you boys feel about that?
Well, of course, it ain't none of our business, but the person starts out being a teacher, she ought to stay one.
How's the knee, Joe?
Fine, Doc. Never think about it at all. Like you said, it always tells you it's gonna rain.
What's it telling you today? Gonna rain?
No, sir.
Sure?
Yes, sir.
You ever made a mistake?
No, sir.
I want to tell you something about that boy, Joe Crowell, there. Joe was awful bright. Graduated from the high school here, head of his class. He got a scholarship to Boston Tech, MIT, that is. Graduated head of his class there, too. It was all written up in the Boston paper at the time. Going to be a great engineer, Joe was. But the war broke out and he died in France. All that education for nothing. Now, what business he had picking a war with the Germans? I can't make out to this day, but it all seemed perfectly fair to us at the time. And there comes Harry Newsom delivering the milk.
Oh, Bessie Grant, what's the matter with you?
Morning, Doc.
Morning, Howie.
Somebody sick?
No, just a pair of twins over in Polish Town.
Twins, eh? Town gets bigger every year.
Gonna rain, Howie?
No, no. Fine day to burn through.
Hello, Bessie.
How old is she, Howie? She's going on 17. And all mixed up about the rhythm. Lockhart stopped taking the cord milk every day. Wants to leave the cord just the same. Keeps going, you know.
Trip. Good morning, Howie.
Morning, Skid. Doc's just coming down the street.
Is he? Seems like you're late today.
Yeah, something wrong with the separator. Don't know what it was. Come on, Betty.
Children, time to get up. Everything all right, Frank?
Yes, I declare, easy as kittens.
Shaking will be ready in a minute. Sit down and drink your coffee. You can catch a couple hours sleep this morning, can't you?
Miss Webber's coming over at 11. Guess I know what it's about, too. Her stomach ain't what it ought to be.
All told, you won't get more than 3 hours sleep. I declare, Frank, I don't know what's going to become of you. I do wish you could get away someplace and take a rest. Emily, time to get up.
Well, Lisa, Bob.
George, you got to go. You'll be late for school.
George, look sharp.
Yes, Bob.
Don't you hear your mother calling you?
Wally, you'll be late for school.
Well, I guess I'll go upstairs and catch 40 minutes.
Wally, wash yourself good or come up and do it myself.
Mom, what dress should I wear?
Don't make a sound. Your father's been out all night and he needs his sleep. I washed and ironed the blue gingham for you special.
Oh, Mom, I hate that dress.
Oh, hush up with you.
Every day I go to school dressed like a sick turkey.
Now, Rebecca.
Pacing it
all out like he was going to buy it.
Well, Julia, if that second-hand man's really serious about buying it, sell it. Then you'll get to see Paris all right. Just keep dropping hints from time to time. That's how I got to see the Atlantic Ocean, you know.
Oh, I'm sorry I mentioned it. Only it seems to me that once in your life, before you die, you ought to see a country where they don't talk in English and don't even want to.
Thank you very much, ladies. Now we'll skip a few hours. But first we want a little more information about our town. Kind of a scientific account, you might say. So I've asked Professor Willard of our state university to come in and sketch a few details of our past history here. Professor Willard? May I introduce Professor Willard of our state university? Fortunately, our time is limited.
Of course. Grover's Corners lies on the old Pliocene granite of the Appalachian Range. Some of the oldest land in the world, I may add. We're very proud of that here. Of course, some more recent outcroppings may be seen. Sandstone showing through a shelf of Devonian basalt with vestiges of Mesozoic shale. But these are comparatively new, perhaps 200 to 300 years old. Some highly interesting fossils have been found just north of here at the Peckham Farm in Silas Peckham's cow pasture. These fossils may be seen in the museum at the university at any time. Shall I read some of Professor Gruber's notes on the meteorological situation, mean precipitation, etc.?
We won't have much time for that, Professor. You might give us a few notes on the interview.
Anthropological data.
Yes.
Amerindian stock of the Canajoharie tribe. No evidence before the 10th century of this era. Now entirely disappeared. Possible traces in 3 families. Migration in the early part of the 17th century of English-speaking brachiocephalic blue-eyed stock. Since then, some Mediterranean and Slav.
And the population, Professor?
2,640.
Just a moment, Professor.
The population at this moment, 2,642. The coastal district brings in an additional 507, bringing the total to 3,149. Mortality and birth rates constant. By McPherson's gauge, 6.032.
Thank you very much, Professor Rob. Very much obliged to you, I'm sure.
Not at all, sir.
Now the political and social report, Editor Webb. Mr. Webb?
He'll be here in a minute. He just cut his hand while Steve and Anna.
Thank you, Ms. Webb.
Charles! Everybody's waiting.
Mr. Webb is a publisher and editor of the Grover's Consent. That's all about the paper, you know. Mr. Webb.
Well, I don't have to tell you that we're run here by a board of selectmen. All males voted at age 21, women vote in direct. We're lower middle class, sprinkled on professional men, 10% illiterate laborers. Politically, we're 86% Republicans, 6% Democrat, 4% socialist, rest, indifferent. Religiously, we're 85% Protestant, 12% Catholic, rest, indifferent.
Have you any comments, Mr. Webb?
Very ordinary town, if you ask me. A little better behaved, most. Probably a little duller. But the younger people here seem to like it well enough. 90% of them graduated from high school and settled down right here, even when they've been away to college.
Now, is there anyone in the audience who would like to ask Mr. Webb any questions about our town?
Mr. Webb?
Yes.
Well, ma'am, I wouldn't know what you'd call much. Saturday nights, farmhands meet down Heller Greenhouse stable and holler some. We've got 1 or 2 town drunks, but they're always having remorses every time evangelist comes to town. No, ma'am, I'd say like you're in a regular thing at home here, except in a medicine chest. Very good for snake bites. Always has been.
Could you come forward, please, where we could all hear you?
Now, what was it you wanted to say?
Is there no one in town aware of social injustice and industrial inequality?
Oh, yes. Everyone is. Something terrible. Talking about who's rich and who's poor.
Then why don't they do something about it?
Well, I don't know. Guess we're all hauling like everyone else for a way that's diligent and sensible can rise to the top. The lazy and quarrelsome can sink to the bottom. But it ain't easy to find. Meantime, we do all that we can to help those that can't help themselves. And those that can, we leave alone. Are there any other questions?
Oh, Mr. Webb.
Yes, ma'am?
Mr. Webb, is there any culture or love of beauty in Grover's Corners?
Well, ma'am, not in the sense that you mean. Come to think of it, there's some girls that play the piano down at the high school commencement. But they ain't happy about it. No, ma'am, there ain't much pleasure. Maybe this is the time to tell you that we've got a pleasure of a kind here. Like watching the sun over the mountains in the morning. We all notice a great deal about the birds. We pay a lot of attention to them. We like to watch the change in seasons, too. But those other things. You're right, ma'am. Very much. Robinson Crusoe and the Bible. Handel's Largo. Yes, we all know about them. And Whistler's Mother. That's about as far as we go.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Now get back to the town. It's 2 o'clock. Now 2,642. We've had the lunches and all the dishes have been washed. All the children have gone back to school. There's a buzzing and a humming from the school buildings. Only a few buggies on Main Street. Horses dozing at the hitching posts. There's an early afternoon calm about the town. Y'all remember what it's like. Doc Gibbs is in his office stepping people and making them say ah. Mr. Webb's got his lawn over there. Now, one man in 10 thinks it's a privilege to push his own lawnmower. No, sir.
I can't tonight, Louise. I gotta go home and help my mother. Bye. Goodbye, Helen.
Emily walks simply. Who do you think you are today?
Oh, Papa, you're just terrible. One minute you tell me to stand up straight, and the next minute you call me names. I just won't listen to you anymore.
Golly, never got a kiss from such a great lady before.
Excuse me, Mrs. Forrest. You go out and play in the fields, young man. You've got no business playing baseball in Main Street.
Awfully sorry, Mrs. Forrest. Well, hello, Emily.
Hello, George.
You made a fine speech in class today.
Well, thanks. I was really ready to make a speech on the Monroe Doctrine, but at the last minute, this court man made me talk about the Louisiana Purchase. I worked an awfully long time on both of them.
Gee, it's funny, Emily. You know, from my window up there, I can just see your head nice when you're all in your room doing your homework.
Why, can you?
Yeah, you certainly do stick to it. I don't see how you can sit still that long. I guess you must like school.
Well, I just figure it's something a person's got to go through.
Yeah.
I don't mind it, really. It passes the time.
Yeah. What do you think, Emily? We might work out a kind of telegraph from your window to mine. And if I get stuck on one of those algebra problems, well, you can give me a hint. Oh, not the answers, Emily. Of course not. Just some little hint.
Oh, well, I guess hints are okay. So, if you get stuck, George, just give me a whistle. I'll give you some hints.
Gee, Emily, I guess you're just naturally bright, I guess.
Well, I just figure it's just the way a person's born.
Yeah, but I want to be a farmer. My Uncle Luke says anytime I want, I can come out and work on his farm. If I'm any good, I can just gradually have it.
You mean the house and everything?
Yeah. Well, I guess I better be getting back to the ball field. Thanks a lot for the talk, Emily. Oh, good afternoon, Mrs. Webb.
Good afternoon, George.
So long, Emily.
So long, George. Emily, sit yourself down here and help me string some of these beans for the winter. Well, George Gibbs let himself have a real conversation, didn't he? How old would George be?
Oh, I don't know.
Let's see, he must be almost 16.
Mama, I made a speech in class today. I was very good.
You must recite it to your father at supper. What was it about?
The Louisiana Purchase. It was just like silk off the spool. When I grow up, I'm going to make speeches all the time. Are these big enough?
Try and get them a little bigger if you can.
Mama, would you answer me a question seriously?
Seriously, dear, not serious.
Seriously, would you?
course I will.
Mama, am I good looking?
Of course you are. Both my children have got good features. I'd be ashamed if they hadn't.
Oh, Mama, that's not what I mean. I mean, am I pretty?
I've already told you yes. You've got a nice, young, pretty face. I've never heard of such foolishness.
Oh, Mama, you know, help it all. Mama, were you pretty when you were young?
Well, I was the prettiest girl in town, next to Mamie Cartwright.
Well, Mama, you just got to say something about me. Am I pretty enough to get people, to get anybody interested in me?
Emily, now stop this. You make me tired. You're pretty enough for all normal purposes. Now come along and bring that bowl with you.
Oh, Mama, you're no help at all.
Now I think this is a good time to tell you that the Cartwright interests have begun building a new bank for Grover's Gardens. Had to go to Vermont for the marble side. They asked a friend of mine what they should put in the cornerstone for people to dig up 1,000 years from now. Of course, we put in a copy of the New York Times and a copy of Mr. Webb's set. You see, we're kind of interested in this. Some scientific fellows have found a way of painting all that reading matter together with a kind of glue, a silica glue. Make it keep all 1,000, 2,000 years. Putting in a Bible and Constitution of the United States and a copy of William Shakespeare's plays. What do you say, folks? What do you think? You know, Babylon once had 2 million people in it. And all we know about it is the names and kings, some copy of wheat contracts, and some slaves. Yes, every night, all those families sat down for supper. Father came home from work and smoking up a chimney. Same as here. And even in Greece and Rome, all we know about the real life of the people is what we can piece together out of the comedies, joking poems they wrote for the theater back then. So, I'm going to have a copy of this play to put in the cornerstone. People 1,000 years from now will know a few simple facts about us. More than the Treaty of Versailles and the Limburg flag. See what I mean? Well, you people 1,000 years from now, this is the way we were in the provinces north of New York at the beginning of the 20th century. This is the way we were in our growing up, in our marrying, in our living, and our dying. Now we'll get back to the town. This evening, you can get choir practice going on at the congregation's church. All the children are at home doing their schoolwork. Cage running down like a tire.
A lot, Emily.
Art thou weary? Art thou angry? It's a question, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies, make it talk.
George, can you come down a minute?
Yes, Pa.
Oh, and remember Sunday, take the second verse real soft. You sort of die out.
George, how old are you?
Me? I'm 16, almost 17.
What do you plan to do after school's over?
Why, you know, Pa, I want to be a farmer on Duluth's farm.
You'll be willing, will you, to get up early and milk and feed the stock and hoe and hay all day?
Why, sure I will. What do you mean, Pa?
Well, George, when I was in my office today, I heard a funny sound. What do you think it was? It was your mother out in the backyard chopping wood. There you see your mother getting up early, washing and ironing all day. Still, she has to go out in the backyard and chop wood. I guess she just got tired of it asking you and decided it would be easy to do it herself. You eat the meals she cooks for you, put on the clothes she keeps nice for you, run off and play baseball. Treat her like some kind of hired girl we keep around, but don't like very much. I knew all I'd have to do was to call your attention to it. Here's a handkerchief, son. George, I'm raising you spending money 25 cents a week. Not for chopping wood for your mother, because that's the sort of present you give her. But because you're getting older, and I imagine there's lots of things you might find to do with it.
Thanks, Bob.
I feel she ought to have more, too. I wonder what could have happened to your mother. Choir practice was never this late before.
Go ahead, Thursday, Bob.
I don't know why she's in that old choir anyway. She ain't got any more voice than an old crow. About time you retired.
Good night, Martha. Good night, Mr. Foster.
I'll tell Mr. Webb. I know he'll want to put it in the paper.
Hi, it's late. Good night, Martha.
It was choir practice, wasn't it?
Myrtle
Webb, look at that moon, will you? Potato weather for sure.
Well, naturally, I didn't want to say a word about it in front of those others. But now we're alone. Really, it's the worst scandal that ever was in this town.
What?
Simon Simpson.
Now, Luella.
But Julia, to have the organs of a church drink and drunk year after year.
Luella.
But Julia, you know he was drunk tonight.
Now, Luella, we all know about Mr. Simpson, and we all know about the troubles he's been through. And Dr. Ferguson knows, too. And if Dr. Ferguson keeps him on there at his job, the only thing the rest of us can do is just not to notice it.
Not to notice it, but it's getting worse.
No, it isn't, Luella. I've been in that choir twice as long as you have, and it doesn't happen anywhere near so often. My, I hate to put a bed in a night like this. Gracious, I better hurry. Those children will be up till all hours of the night. Good night, Julia.
Good night, Luella. Good night, Myrtle. Can you get home safe, Luella? Oh, it's as bright as day. I can see Mr. Stone scowling at the windows now. You think you've been to a dance the way the men call carry on? Good night, Julia.
Good night, Luella.
See you on Sunday.
See you then. Well, we had a real nice choir practice.
You're late enough.
Why, Frank, it ain't any later than usual.
And you stepping at the corner to gossip with a lot of hands.
No, Frank, don't be grouchy. Come on, let's smell my heliotrope in the moonlight. Come on. Isn't that wonderful? What did you do all the time I was away?
Oh, I read as usual. What were the girls gossiping about tonight?
Well, believe me, Frank, there was something to gossip about.
And Simon Simpson far gone, was he?
Worst I've ever seen him. How will that end, Frank? Dr. Ferguson can't forgive him forever.
I guess I know more about Simon Simpson's affairs than anyone else in this town. Some people just ain't made for small town life. Don't know how that'll end. I guess there's just nothing we can do but leave it alone. Get in.
No, not yet. Frank, I'm worried about you.
What are you worried about?
I feel that it's my duty to see that you get away for a real rest and change. And if I get that legacy, I'm going to insist on it.
No, Julia, there's no use in going over that again.
Frank, you're just unreasonable.
Come on, start getting inside. It's getting late. Before you know it, you'll catch cold. Hey, George, appease my mind tonight. have your wood chopped. For a while, anyway.
Oh, dear. There's always so many things to pick up, seems like.
No, start getting upstairs.
You know, Frank, Mrs. Fairchild always locks her front door every night. All those people up that part of town do.
They're all getting citified. That's the trouble with them. They ain't got anything fit to burgle, and everybody knows it.
Hey, get out, Rebecca. There's only room for one at this window.
Well, let me just look.
Use your own window.
I did, but there's no moon out there. George, you know what I think? I think the moon's getting nearer and nearer. It's going to be a big explosion.
Oh, Rebecca, you don't know anything. If the moon were getting nearer, the men would have all night with their telescopes to see it first, and they'd tell everybody, and it'd be in all the newspapers.
George, is the moon shining on Canada, South America, half the whole world?
Well, probably is.
Nine 9:30. Most of the lights in town are out. There's Constable Warren trying a few doors on Main Street. And here comes Editor Webb after putting his newspaper to bed.
Evening, Bill.
Evening, Mr. Webb.
Quite a move.
Yeah.
Not quiet down tonight?
Simon Stimson is rolling around a little. Just saw his wife who went out to hunt for him. So I looked the other way. I hear he's something now.
Evening. Most of the town settled down for the night. Yes, most of the town settled down for tonight. Can I walk along with you? Night. This is a heck of trouble. One thing after another. Oh, Bill, did you see my boy smoking a cigarette? Did you give him a word? Thanks a lot.
I don't think he smokes any cigarettes, Mr. Webb. Leastways, not more than 2 or 3 a year.
Hope not. Who's that up there? Is that you, Myrtle?
It's me, Papa.
What are you doing out of bed?
Oh, I can't sleep tonight. The moonlight's just so beautiful. And the smell of Mrs. Gibbs' heliotrope. Do you smell it?
Yes. Having any troubles on your mind, have you, Evelyn?
Troubles? No, Papa.
Don't let your mother catch you. Good night.
Good night, Papa.
I never told you about the letter Jane Crowfoot got from her minister when she was sick. You wrote Jane a letter, and on the envelope it read, Jane Crowfoot, the Crowfoot Farm, Grover's Corners, Sutton County, New Hampshire, United States of America.
What's so funny about that?
Well, listen, it's not finished. United States of America, continent of North America, the Western Hemisphere, the world, the solar system, the universe, the mind of God.
What do you know?
Yep, and the postman brought it just the same.
What do you know?
That's the end of the first act, friend. You can go out and smoke now. That was the smoke. Love and marriage. There's another act after this. I reckon you can guess what that's about. So, it's 19 all fall. It's July 7th, just after high school commencement. Now, that's the time most of the young people jump off and get married. As soon as they pass the last examinations in solid geometry, Cicero's orations, it looks like they suddenly feel themselves fit to get married. Morning again. This time it's been raining. It's been lightning, thundering. Miss Gibbs' garden, Mrs. Webster's, drenched. All those bean poles and peavines drenched. Yesterday on Main Street, the rain was like curtains being blown along. I don't know now, maybe again any minute. Yep, and there's the 5:45 for Boston. And there's Miss Gibbs and Miss Webb. Come downstairs to make breakfast, just if it were not day. I don't have to point out to the women in my audience that both these ladies this evening bought them. Both these ladies cook three meals a day. One of them for 20 years, the other for 40, and no summer vacation. I brought up two children apiece, washed, cleaned the house, and never a nervous breakdown. They never felt themselves hard used either. It's like what one of those Middle West poets said. You got to love life. To have life. And you've got to have life. To love life. What they call a vicious circle. And there's Sally Newsom, the best is living in milk. And there's Wally Webb, fouling in his father's footsteps.
Morning, Howie. Morning, Wally. You see the papers on a note?
Nothing
much, except blue, best baseball pitcher girl
as far as ever had. Yeah, reckon he is. Tell him you're doing
his pitcher, hey. Whoa, Bessie,
it's like a
couple of talks
about
mine, too. Did you hit, too, for run bases?
Yeah, mighty fine ball, player.
I don't see how you
go
about things like that. Just get married.
Would you have, Howie? Oh, no,
Wally,
never had no tennis that way.
Morning, Howie.
Morning, Bill. You're up early.
See if there's anything they can do to prevent a flood. The river's been rising all night.
Wally here's all broke up about George Gibbs at the time of the baseball.
That's the way it goes, Wally. In 84, we had a ball player. Even George Gibbs couldn't touch him. Name of Hank Todd. Went down to Maine and became a parson. Wonderful ball player. How's the weather seem to you, Howie?
Oh, it ain't bad. I think maybe it'll clear for good.
Good morning, Howie.
Morning, Skids. How much was your day?
Well, Howie, I've got a house full of relations. Looks to me like only three milk and two a cream.
Three milk and two a cream. My wife told me to tell you how we hope they'll be happy. I know they will.
Thanks a lot, Howie. Tell your wife I hope she can make it to the wedding.
Maybe she can. You get there if she can.
George.
Oh. Morning, Mr. Newsom.
Morning, Miss Webb.
I told you 4 quarts of milk. I hope you can spare me another.
Yes, we can do a cream.
Will it start raining again today, Howie?
Well, I was just saying Mrs. Gibbs helped me clear up for good. My wife told me to tell you specialists how we hope they'll be happy. I know they will.
Well, thank you. Thank Mrs. Newsom. We're counting on seeing you at the church.
Wouldn't miss that. Come on, Mrs. Get
out. Well, Ma, the day has come. You're losing one of your chicks.
Frank Gibbs, don't say another word. I feel like crying every minute. Sit down and drink your coffee.
Good enough, shave yourself. But it seems to me there ain't an awful lot to shave. He's singing like he's glad to leave us. Every once in a while he says, I do. That don't sound convincing to me.
How will they get along, Frank? I've arranged his clothes, he's tuned, his feet are dry, and he's got warm things on. They're too young, Frank. Emily won't think of such things.
I remember my wedding morning, Julia.
Now don't start that, Frank.
Well, I was the scaredest young fellow in the state of New Hampshire. I thought I'd made a mistake for sure. When I saw you coming down that aisle, I thought you were the prettiest girl I'd ever seen. The only problem was I'd never seen you before. There I was in the Congregational Church marrying a total stranger.
How do you think I felt? Weddings are perfectly awful things, Frank. Farces, that's what they are. Here, I've made you something.
Why, Julia Hershey, French toast.
Hey, hard to make, and I had to do something.
How'd you sleep last night, Julia?
Well, I heard an awful lot of the hours struck off.
Yeah, I get a shock every time I think of George setting out to be a family man. That great game and thing, tell you, Julia, there's nothing so terrifying in the world as a son. The relationship of father to son is the damnedest.
Well, mother and daughters don't picnic, let me tell you.
Well, we'll have the troubles, I suppose, but that's none of our business. Everybody has the right to their own troubles.
Yep. People are meant to live two by twos in this world. It ain't natural to be lonesome.
Julia, you know what I was afraid of when I married you?
Oh, go on with you.
I was afraid you wouldn't have material for conversation more than the last 2 weeks. I was scared you'd run out and eat our meals in silence. You and I have been conversing for 40 years now without any noticeable bearing spell.
Well, good weather, bad weather, ain't very choice, but I always find something to say. Have you heard Rebecca stirring around upstairs?
No, only day two she has been managing everybody else's business. Got the idea she's crying.
Lord's sake, it's got to stop. Rebecca! Rebecca, come down here and eat your breakfast.
Morning, everybody. Only 4 more hours to live.
Yes, where are you going?
I'm just stepping across the grass to see my girl.
Well, put your rubbers on. It's been raining torrents. I won't have you going out of this house without your prepared for it.
Oh, Ma, it's just a step.
You'll catch your death of cold and cough all through the service.
George, do as your mother tells you.
From tomorrow on, you can kill yourself in all weathers. But while you're in my house, you'll look wisely, thank you. Perhaps Mrs. Webb can use the collars at 7 o'clock in the morning. Here, take a cup of coffee.
I'll be back in just a minute. Morning, Mrs. Webb.
Morning, George. Goodness, you frightened me. Now, George, you come in for a minute and stand out of the rain. You really understand I can't ask you in.
Why not?
George, you know as well as I do, the groom can't see the bride on the wedding day. Not until he's seen her in church.
Oh, that's just an old superstition. Morning, Mr. Webb.
Morning, George.
You don't believe in that old superstition, do you, Mr. Webb?
Well, George, there's a lot of common sense in superstition.
Millions have followed it, George. Don't you be the first to fly in the face of custom.
How's Emma?
She hasn't waked up yet.
She's asleep.
Well, no wonder. We were up till all hours of the night, sewing and packing. I'll tell you what I'll do, though, George. You sit down here and drink a cup of coffee with Mr. Webb.
Best thing to do is give an order about something, even if it doesn't make sense. just so she'll learn to obey, he said. Then he said, if anything about her irritates you, conversation, or anything, just get right up and leave. That'll make you feel good. Oh, yes. And then he said, never let your wife know how much money you have. Never.
Well, Mr. Webb, I don't know, man. I could exactly do all of it.
So I took the opposite of his advice, and I've been happy ever since. Let that be a lesson to you, George. Never to waste advice on anyone on personal matters. George, are you going to raise chickens on your farm?
What?
Are you going to raise chickens on your farm?
Why, yes. Well, Uncle Luke never wasted for chickens much, but I've been thinking about eating up.
George, Luke came to my office the other day in a file system for raising chickens. How was she reading? I'm thinking of getting a small egg myself in the backyard. I'm going to put an incubator in the cellar.
Charles Webb, are you talking about that old incubator again? I thought you two would be talking about things more worthwhile.
Well, Myrtle, if you want to give the boys some good advice, I'll go upstairs.
Now, George, Emily's got to come down and eat a breakfast. She sends you a love. She doesn't want to lay her eyes on you. Goodbye.
Bye. Myrtle, guess you haven't heard about that older superstition.
What do you mean, Charles?
Ever since this came, man, no bridegroom. Father-in-law on the day of the wedding for dear. Now remember that.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Now I have to interrupt you again.
You see, you want to know how all this began.
This wedding, to kind of spend a lifetime together. You know, I'm awfully interested in how big things like that begin. You know how it is. 21 and 22, you make some decisions and wish. You're 70, you've been a lawyer for 50 years, and that white-haired lady of desire has eaten over 50,000 meals with you. Such things begin. George and Emily are going to show you now the conversation they had when they first knew that, as the saying goes, they were meant for each other. Before they do that, I want you to try and remember what it was like when you were young, particularly the days when you were first in love, when you were like a person sleepwalking. You didn't quite see the streets you were walking in, and you didn't quite hear everything that was said to you. It was a little bit crazy. Will you remember that, please? Now, they'll be coming out of high school at 3 o'clock. George has just been elected president of the senior class, and as this is June, that means he'll be president of the senior class all next year. Emma's just been elected secretary and treasurer. And they're coming down Main Street now.
I can't tonight, Louise. I've got to go home and help my mother. Oh, Ernestine, can you come over tonight and do Latin? Isn't that Cicero just awful? Well, tell your mother that you have to. Goodbye. Bye, Helen.
Say, Emily, can I carry your books home for you?
Thanks, George. It's not far.
Can you wait just a minute, Emily? Say, Bob, if Bob will only start practice and give Herb some long high ones.
Goodbye, Lizzie.
Goodbye, Lizzie. I'm awfully glad you're elected too, Emily.
Thank you.
Oh, Emily, why are you mad at me?
I'm not mad at you, George.
Well, you've been treating me so funny lately.
Well, since you mentioned it, I might as well tell you right now. Oh, goodbye, Miss Corcoran.
Goodbye, Miss Corcoran. What is it?
Well, George, I don't like the whole change that's come over you in the past year. And I'm sorry if it hurt your feelings, but I just gotta tell the truth and shame the devil.
A change? Well, what do you mean?
Well, up until a year ago, I really used to like you a lot. I used to watch every Well, we've been friends for such a long time. And then you started spending all your time at baseball. And you never stopped to speak to anybody. Not to really speak. Not even to your own family. And George Gibbs is a fact. Ever since you were elected captain of the baseball team, you've gotten awful stuck up and conceited. And even the girls say so. And it hurts me to hear him say it. Even though I got to agree with him a little bit. Because it's true.
Well, gosh, Emily. I never realized such a thing was happening to me. I guess it's kind of hard for a fellow not to have some faults creep into his character.
I always expect the man to be perfect, and I think he should be.
I don't think it's all to be perfect, Emily.
Well, my father is, and as far as I can see, your father is too. So there's no reason why you shouldn't be.
Well, I feel it's the other way around. The men aren't naturally good, but girls are.
Well, I might as well tell you.
crying about?
Well, she just got an awful scare, Mr. Morgan. That hardware store lady almost ran her over. Everybody says Thomas gets crying like a crazy man.
Here, you take a good drink of water, Emily. You'll have gone shook up. You've got to look both ways before you cross Main Street these days. It gets worse every year. There you are. Now, what you have?
I'll have a strawberry phosphate, Mr. Morgan.
No, Emily, you have an ice cream soda with me.
Well.
Two strawberry ice cream sodas, Mr. Morgan.
Ooh, strawberry ice cream soda.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. There are 225 horses in Grover's Corners this minute I'm talking to you. State Inspector was in here yesterday. Now they're bringing in these automobiles. Best thing to do is just stay home. Well, I can remember when a dog could lie down in the middle of Main Street all day and nothing ever come to disturb him. Yes, Miss Alice. I'll be with you in a minute. There we go. There you are. Now, what can I do for you?
Oh, George, they're so expensive.
No, Emily, don't you think about that. We're celebrating our election. Do you know what else I'm celebrating?
What?
I'm celebrating that I've got a good enough friend who tells me what ought to be told me.
Oh, George, don't even think about that. I don't know what means.
Emily, you stick to it. I'm glad you spoke to me like you did. But you'll see, I'm going to change so quick, you bet I'm going to change. And Emily, I want to ask you a favor.
What?
When I go away to State Agriculture College next year, will you write me a letter once in a while?
Certainly. I certainly will. It certainly seems that being away at college for 3 years, a person can get out of touch with things. I realize that after a while, letters from Grover's Corners won't be that interesting. Grover's Corners isn't a very important place when you think of all New Hampshire. But I think it's a very nice town.
Oh, Emily, the day wouldn't come when I wouldn't want to know everything about our town. I know that's true, Emily.
I tried to make the letters as interesting as possible.
You know, Emily, whenever I meet a farmer, I ask him if he thinks it's important to go to agriculture school to be a good farmer.
Why, George?
Yeah, some say it's even a waste of time. Why, sure, you get all that stuff anyway the pamphlets the government sends out. and Uncle Luke's getting old. He's about ready for me to start taking over the farm tomorrow if I could.
My.
And like you say, being away all that time in other places and meeting other people, well, gosh, if anything like that can happen, I don't want to go away. I guess new people aren't any better than old ones. I bet they almost never are. I feel you're as good a friend as I've got, Emily. I don't need to go and meet the other people in other towns.
Well, George, I should think that it would be important for you to go away to college and learn about cattle judging and soils and things like that. But of course I wouldn't.
No, Emily, I'll make up my mind right now. I won't go. I'll tell Pa about it tonight.
Well, you don't have to decide right now, George. It's a whole year away.
Emily, I'm glad you spoke to you about that. That fault in my character. You were right. But there's one thing wrong in it. Where you said I wasn't noticing people. And what are you, for instance? You said you were watching while I did everything? Well, I was doing the same thing with you the whole time. Why, sure. I always thought you was one of the chief people I always thought about. I always made sure where you were sitting on the bleachers and who you were with. And for 3 days now, I've tried to walk home with you, but something's always gotten in the way. Yesterday, I was over waiting by the wall for you, and you walked home with Miss Corcoran.
Oh, George, isn't life funny? How was I supposed to know?
I'm going to tell you why I'm not going to agriculture school next year. Well, I think when you found a person that you're fond of, and who's fond of you too, and who cares enough about you to be interested in your character, well, I think that's just as important as college. And even more so. That's what I think.
Well, I think that's important too, George.
Say, Emily. If I do improve and make a big change, would you be, I mean, could you be?
Oh, George, I am now and I always have been.
So I guess it's an important talk we've been having.
I guess.
say, Mr. Morgan, I'm gonna have to go home and get the money to pay for this.
Watch the judge, Gambers. You make it count.
Yes, Mr. Morgan, but I have my reasons. Well, here. Now my gold watch to hold on to till I come back with the money.
That's right, George. Keep your watch. I'll trust you.
I'm back in 5 minutes.
I'll trust you. 10 years, George. Not today.
Now come over to your shop, Gambers.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Morgan. It was nothing.
I'm ready. Well, now we can get down to the wet.
There are a lot of things to be said about the wedding. There are a lot of thoughts that go on during the wedding. We can't get them all into one wedding, naturally, and especially not to a wedding in Grover's Corners with a mighty short play. In this play, I take the part of the minister, so that gives you the right to say a few more things. Yes, for a while now the play gets pretty serious. You see, they say marriage is a sacrament. Well, I don't quite know what that means, but I can guess. I guess it's like what Miss Gibbs said a few minutes ago. People were made to live too much. This is a good wedding. The people are pretty young, but they come from a good state. They chose right. The real hero of the scene isn't on the stage at all, and I think y'all know who that is. It's like what one of those European fellows said. Every time a child is born into the world, it's nature's attempt to try and make a perfect human being. Well, we have seen nature pushing and contriving for some time now. No, no, she's interested in quantity, but I think she's interested in quality, too. Maybe she's trying to make another good governor for New Hampshire. No, that's what Emily hopes. Don't forget the other witnesses at this wedding. The ancestors. Millions of them. Most of them set out to live 2x2 also. Millions of them. Well, that's all my sermon. Wasn't very long anyhow.
Thursday night. Emily and I are coming over to dinner every Thursday night. You'll see. Why, Ma, you look all funny. What are you crying for? Come on, we gotta get ready for this.
I never felt so alone in my whole life. There's George over there. I hate him. Oh, I wish I was dead. Papa! Oh, Papa, why can't I just stay as I am just for a little while? There must be lots of places we could go.
Stop and think.
But, Papa, I don't want to get married.
Well, you're just nervous.
Papa, don't you remember what you used to say all the time that I was your girl? There must be lots of places we can go. I could work for you. I could keep house.
Emily, stop and think a minute.
George, could you come over here a minute?
Well, you're marrying the best young fellow in the world. George is a fine fellow.
Papa?
I'm giving away my daughter, George. Do you think you can take care of her?
I want to, Mr. Webb. I want to try. Emily, I'm going to try my best. I love you.
If you love me, help me. I want someone to love me.
I will, Emily. Emily, I'll try.
And I mean forever, do you hear? Forever and ever.
This time 9 years have gone by, friends. Summer, 1913. Gradual changes in Grover's corn. Corpses are getting rare. Farmers coming into town in fawns. Everybody locks the house doors now at night, so ain't been any burglars, but everybody's heard about them. And yet, you'd be surprised, though, on the whole, things don't change much around here. This certainly is an important part of Robert's Commons. Then a hilltop, windy hilltop, lots of sky, lots of clouds, often lots of sun and moon and stars. You come up here on a fine afternoon and you can see range on range of up who they are, up there by Lake Sunapee, Lake Winnipeg South. And if you go way up, you can see the White Mountains, Mount Washington, North Conway and Conway. Their favorite mountain, Mount Monadnock, right here. And all around it lie these towns. Jeffrey, North Jeffrey, Peterborough, Dublin. Right there, right away down, Dover's Commons. Yes, beautiful spot up here. Mountain laurel and lilacs. You know, I often wonder why people like to be buried in Woodlawn and Brooklyn. They might pass the time up here in New Hampshire. Now over there are the old stones. 1670, 1680. Strong-minded people come a long way to be independent. Some of the people come up here laughing at the funny words on the tombstones. They don't do any harm. Genealogists, they get paid by city folk. They want to make sure they're doctors of the American Revolution and of the mainland. Well, I guess that don't do any harm either. There's some Civil War veterans over here, too. And flags in the graves. And a notion the Union ought to be kept together. But they've never seen more than 50 miles of it themselves. All they knew was a name, friends. The United States of America. United States of America. And they went and died about it. This here's a new part of the cemetery. There's a friend, Miss Gibbs. Mr. Stimson, organist for the Congregational Church. You remember. Oh, and a lot of others. And Editor Webb's boy Ross. Appendix first in the Boy Scout trip to Crowd of Nut. Yes. An awful lot of sorrow, sort of. Trying to die from here. People just wild and grief brought their relatives up to this here. You know how it is.
And then,
times. Sunny days, rainy days, snow. A lot of thoughts come up here night and day, but there's no folks on this.
Now, there are some things that we all know, but we don't take them out. Look at it very often.
We all know that something is eternal. And it ain't houses, and it ain't names, and it ain't the earth, and it ain't even the stars. Everybody knows in the bones that something is eternal. That something has to do with human beings. All the greatest people that ever lived have been telling us that for 5,000 years. Yet you'd be surprised if people have always let go of that fact. Something way down deep is eternal about every human being.
Well, you know as well as I do that they're dead. And they don't stay interested in us living people for very long.
No, gradually they let go hold of the earth, the ambitions they had, the pleasures they had, the things they suffered, the people they love. They get weaned away from the earth. Well, that's the way I like to put it, weaned away. They stay here while the earth part of it burns away, burns out. And all the while, slowly getting indifferent to what's going on, grows calm. You see, they're waiting for something they feel is coming, something important and great. Well, aren't they waiting for the eternal part of them to come out clear? Now, some of the things they say maybe don't let you feel it. That's the way it is. Mother and daughter, husband and wife, enemy and enemy, money and lies, and all those terribly important things. And to go hair around here. what's left. What's left of it? Memory's gone. Your identity. Excuse me. Well, here's some living people. There's Joe Stoddard, our undertaker, supervising the new main grave. There's Sam Gray, the Rover's Congress boy that left town to go out west.
Good afternoon, Joe Stoddard.
Good afternoon. See, do I know you?
I'm Sam Gray.
For gracious sakes alive, all people. Should have known you'd be back for the funeral. Been away a long time, Samuel.
Yes, I've been away over 12 years. I get a business on Buffalo. I was in the East when I heard the awful news of my cousin's death. So I combined things, back to the old home. You look well.
Yes, can't complain. Pretty sad I've done it today, Samuel.
Yes.
As I always say, I hate to supervise when a young person is taken. But I thought I'd come up here a bit early, get things prepared. My son's supervising back at the hall.
A whole department of nurses. I used to do chores when I was after school.
Yeah, he died a number of years ago.
Why, this is my Aunt Julia. I've forgotten she. Of course.
Yes, Dr. Gibbs lost his wife about 2 or 3 years ago. In fact, about this time, actually. Days was a bad blow for him, too.
That's my sister Carrie's boy. Sam Craig.
I get very uncomfortable with her around.
Simon, do they choose their own verses much?
No, not usual. Usually bereaved, pick verse.
It doesn't sound like my Aunt Julia. You know, there ain't many of those Hershey sisters left now, I suppose. Tomorrow I'm going to look at my mother and father's.
Okay, over there, down there by Avenue F, Craig's.
Simon Simpson. Who's church organ? Drank a lot, you used to say.
No one was supposed to know about that, though. He'd back to trouble. Took his own life, you say.
Well, did he?
Yeah, hung himself in the attic, he did. See there, he chose his own epitaph. It's right there. It exactly is ours.
Just a bunch of notes. It was me.
Oh, I was annoyed. It was all written up in the Boston papers at the time.
Joe, what did she die of?
Who?
My cousin.
Well, didn't you know? Had a bit of trouble bringing a baby into the world. It was a second, though. Boy, about four.
You raised somebody over there?
Yeah. There's not a whole lot of home room over here by the Gibbses. So they're putting in a whole new Gibbs section over here. Uh-oh, I can see that coming. Keep going.
My daughter-in-law, Emily Webb.
My, the road up here must have been awful muddy. What'd she die of, Julia?
In childbirth.
Childbirth? Oh, I'd forgotten about that. Wasn't life awful? And
wonderful, was it?
Simon, now remember.
I remember Emily's wedding. That was a perfectly lovely wedding. And I remember her reading the class poem, the graduation exercises. Emily's one of the brightest girls in high school. I've heard Principal Wilkins say so time after time. I called on them at their new farm just before I died. Principal's beautiful farm.
It's on the same road we lived on.
Yep, right, smart farm.
That's my favorite hymn. I was hoping they'd sing again.
Don't you remember?
$350.
Yes, Emily.
Well, anyway, there's a patent device on that drinking fountain so that never overflows by the kids and never sinks below a certain mark they have there. It's right fine. It won't be the same to George without me, but it's a beautiful find.
A lot of people don't understand, do they?
No, dear. Not very much.
They're all sort of shut up in little boxes, aren't they? I feel as though I knew them last 1,000 years ago. Look, they're gone now. My little boy is spending the day at Mrs. McCarthy's. Oh, Mr. McCarthy, my little boy is spending the day over at your farm.
Oh, is he?
Yes, he loves it there. We have a Ford, too, Mother Gibbs. Never gives any trouble. I don't drive it, though.
Mother Gibbs, how long before this feeling goes away? Of being one of them, how long before it just wakes patience here? Look. Father Gibbs is bringing you some of my flowers. He looks just like George, doesn't he? You know, I never realized before how dark and alone my persons really are. Look at him, I love him so. From morning to night, that's all they are, is trouble.
A little cooler than it was.
Yep, that rain's cooled off a little.
Those northern east winds always do the same thing. If it ain't a rain, it's a 3-day blow.
But Mother Gibbs, when can go back? When can go back into the living? I feel it. I know it. I just said for a moment, I was thinking about the farm, and for a minute, my baby was on my lap as plain as day. I can go back and live all those days over again. Why not?
All I can say is, Emily, don't.
But it's true, isn't it? I can go back into the living again?
Yes. Let's have a try. They soon come back.
Don't do it, Emily.
Emily, don't.
But I won't live over a sad day. I'll choose a happy one. I'll choose the day I first knew that I loved George.
Oh, no. Why should that be painful?
You not only live it, but you watch yourself live it. As you watch yourself, you see the thing that they down there never know. You see the future. You know what's going to happen afterwards.
But is that painful? Why?
That's not the only reason why you shouldn't do it, Emily. If you've been here longer, you'll understand. Our life here is to forget all that. Think only of what is ahead. Be ready for what is ahead. When you've been here longer, you'll see.
But Mother Gibbs, how can I ever forget that life? That's all I know. That's all I had.
Emily, it isn't wise, really, it isn't.
But it's something I must know for myself. So, I'll choose a happy day.
At least choose an unimportant day. Choose the least important day of your life. It will be important enough.
And it can't be since I was married. Or since the baby was born. I can choose a birthday at least, can't I? I'll choose my 12th.
All right, February 11th, 1899, Tuesday. You want any special time today?
I want the whole day.
We're getting dark. You remember, it's been snowing for several days, but it stopped the night before. They've got to clear the road. The sun's coming up.
Look, there's Main Street. There's Mr. Morgan's store before he changed it. And why, there's the livery stable. This is the town I knew as a little girl.
Yes, this is 1899. This is 14 years ago.
And there's the white picket fence that used to be around our house. I'd forgotten all about that. I love it, right? Are they here?
Yes. Your mother will be coming downstairs in a few minutes to make breakfast.
Is she?
Did you remember? Your father had been away for several days. He came back on the early morning train.
No.
He'd been back to make a speech at his college in Western New York.
Look! There's Howie Newsom! And there's our policeman.
Well, let's get
in. Then he died.
Morning, Bill.
Morning, Howie.
You're up early?
Been rescuing a fella down by Polish Town. Got drunk and lay off the snowdrift. Thought he was in bed when I shook him.
Look, there's Joe Powell.
Morning, Joe.
Children, 7 o'clock. Time to get up. Mama, I'm here. You can come down and dress by the kitchen fire if you like, but hurry. Oh, how beautiful Mama looks. I never knew she was himself wrapped up.
Yeah? Look at here, Miss Webb.
Mama, I can't find my blue hair ribbon anywhere.
Just open your eyes, dear, that's all. Let it out for your special on the dresser. If it were a snake, it would bite you.
Yes.
Morning, Bill.
Morning, Mr. Webb. You're up early.
Yes, just been back from my old college in New York State. Everything all right here?
Been rescuing a Polish fella. Darn near froze to death, he was. Got drunk and lay on the snowdrift.
We must get it in paper.
Wasn't much.
Morning, Mother.
How'd it go, Charles?
Oh, fine, I guess. I told you. Everything all right here?
Yes. Can't think of anything that happened special. And right cold. Howie Newsom says it's 10 below over to his barn.
Oh, it's colder than that over in Hamilton College. Students' ears have fallen off. Did paper have any mistakes?
No, none that I noticed. Coffee's ready when you want it, Charles. Don't forget, it's Emily's birthday. Remember to get her anything?
Yes, I've got something right here for her. Where's my girl? Where's my birthday girl?
Don't interrupt her now, Charles. You're here at breakfast. She's slow enough as it is.
Mama, I'm here. I love you all. Everything. I can't look at everything so hard enough. Can I go in?
Good morning, Mama.
Well done, dear. Very happy birthday to my girl. Many happy returns.
There are surprises waiting for you on the table.
Thank you, Mommy. You shouldn't have.
I can't. For birthday or no birthday, I want you to eat your breakfast good and slow. I want you to grow up to be a good, strong girl. That and the blue papers from your Aunt Carrie, and I reckon you can guess who brought over the postcard album. Found it on the doorstep when I brought in the milk. George Gibbs. Must have come over in the cold pretty early. Right nice of him.
Oh, George, I've forgotten all about that.
Chew that baking good and slow to help keep you warm on a cold day.
Mama, just once. Look at me as though you really saw me. Mama, 14 years have gone by. I'm dead, Mama. I married George Gibbs. Your grandmother, Mama. Mama, Wally's dead, too. His appendix burst on a camping trip to Crawford Knox. We felt just terrible about it. Don't you remember? Mama, now that we're all here, Mama, let's be happy. Mama, let's look at one another.
That and the yellow paper is something I found in the attic among your grandmother's things. You're old enough to wear it now, and I thought you'd like it.
And Mama, why, this is from you. It's just lovely. It's just what I wanted.
Well, I hoped you'd like it. Hunted all over. Brett and Nora couldn't find one in Concord. We had to send all the way to Boston. Wally has something for you, too. He made it in manual training class. He's very proud of it. Be sure to make a big fuss over it. Father has something for you, too. Don't know what it is myself. Shh, here he comes.
Where's my birthday girl?
Oh, I can't bear it! It goes so fast we don't have time to look at one another. I never realized so much was going on and we never noticed. Take me back. Gregory, one thing. Goodbye. Goodbye, world.
And Mama and Papa.
And the clock's ticking.
And my buttercup tree.
And to Mama's sunflowers. And food and hot coffee. And fresh iron dresses and hot baths. And sleeping and waking up. Oh, Earth, you're too wonderful for anyone to realize you.
Many human beings realize life as they live it every minute.
No. Saints and poets, please. Babes.
Were you happy?
No.
I should have listened to you.
That's all blind persons are, just blind people.
stars are coming out. Oh, Mr. Stimson, I should have listened to them.
Yes. Now you know. Now you know that's what it was to be alive. To move about in the thought of ignorance. To go up and down trampling on feelings of those about you. To spend and waste time as though you had a million years. To always be at the mercy of one's self-centered passion or another. Now you know that's the happy existence you want to go back to. Ignorance and blindness.
That ain't the whole truth, Simon, and you know it. Emily, look at that star. I forget its name.
My boy Joel was a sailor. Drew a bomb. He used to set out on the 14th and tell them all my name. Yes, sir, wonderful.
Stars mighty good company.
There's one of them, Tom.
Why, I think no time to get me here. For goodness sake. Look at Gibbs. It's George. Just rust yourself, dear.
My boy Joel, the stars, he used to say it took millions of years for that little pickle to get down to Earth. Don't seem like a body to believe it, but that's what he used to say. Millions of years.
Goodness, that ain't going to be made. He ought to be home. Mother Gibbs? Yes, Emily?
They don't understand.
No, dear. They don't understand.
Most everybody's asleep in Grover's Gardens. There are a few lights up. Shorty Hawkins down at the depot's just watched the Albany train go by, and somebody's setting up late talk in the livery stable. Yes, it's clear enough. They're the stars. They're old crisscross journeys in the sky. Scholars haven't said the matter much, but they seem to think they're no living beings up there. They're just chalk. Fire. Only this straining away. Straining away all the time to make something of itself. Faint so great that every 16 hours everybody lies down and gets a rest. Everybody's resting in Rose Gardens. Tomorrow will be another day. You get a good rest too. Night.
We would like to recognize
guys, Becky Buttles, Kelly Hurd, Tessie Cranker, and Carrie Clapper filled in for her tonight, we believe. This is Rebecca. Dennis Chase, Lisa Keller, and also Brian Reese filled in for her tonight, and Joe DeGeneiro. Is Joe here?
Joe.
Is Joe here?
Joe's here.
We have a special. There he is. He's coming. He's coming. Hey, Kelly.
Kelly.
Right there. Okay.
Kelly.
Best if you leave.